Here is Jen Nelken. Take it away, Jen.
Okay, I'm on. All right, great. I'm going to tie myself up here too. Hi, everyone. I'm Jen. I'm from Gotham Greens. Thank you so much for having me speak today. There is quite a caliber of speakers here. You know, vertical farming, you know, Dixon and I are New Yorkers here, and so I've spoken on some panels with Dixon over the years. And, you know, it's amazing being in New York City too with our project, how much people love this idea. And I think that that's something that's so important about the vertical farm. I mean, so many different disciplines are really, you know, the idea has gone viral, and so there is something to be captured there. So what I wanted to focus on today was, you know, we have Gotham Greens. We have Dixon showed a picture of it. We have a greenhouse on a roof in New York City. We've been operational for over a year. We sell produce throughout the New York City market. And so I'm not really giving a story about Gotham Greens, but I tried to highlight in all the different slides things that have been challenging for us or things that we think a lot about over the last couple years and how that might be applied here today. So I just wanted to start with this. This is just, you know, keeping things simple is what has been the most important for us. Really important for me too. You know, I think a lot of part what makes Gotham Greens successful right now is that, you know, I've had to make sure it doesn't track my personal interests. You know, it doesn't have too many missions. You know, it's not meant to be a production facility and an educational facility and try to achieve, you know, net zero carbon emissions all right out of the gate. You know, we have been really careful to try to execute on single tasks and to really stay focused. And I think that's been important for us. As we grow as a company, that'll change. But right now, all we want to do is we want to grow a plant and we want to grow it in the city. That's it. In our effort to stay focused, this is just a commercial production facility that we're trying to build, that we've built. The absolute goal of our company is to grow the highest quality plants available on the market. We started with something that we believe to be a commercially viable size so that we can make some mistakes on the first one. We collect a ton of data. You know, I was pretty animate with my partners that, you know, they, from the business background, want to grow and drop, you know, five in New York City in the first year, you know, and I was really animate about us getting a lot of data first and that I wouldn't do another one until we had a year of data from the first one. Variety trials in every single season, climate data for all the seasons. You know, when we started, all I had was maybe some NASA data or the weather stations in Central Park, but now we have data. I know what the climate is on a rooftop in New York City, and there are definitely things that we're doing different the next time around. What we want to do is we want to develop a good business model. You know, this is not a research site. I mean, we have our own R&D, but it's not a research facility. It's not a nonprofit. We need to pay back the investors and the bank. We wanted to build this. We didn't really want unknown variables. We just wanted to see, can you run a good business and produce the best quality product in the city? We weren't trying to invent any technologies here. We wanted to take things that exist and that work well and let the city be the only unknowns for this. So I just wanted to put this order of operations up. This is kind of, you know, how I, if I was going to be the one who had to build a vertical farm, this is kind of the order that I would do things. Definitely because I would look at it as that I would be building, you know, a company. So, you know, who owns this thing? What's the partnership? I think that that is, you know, so important. What's happening with everything that you grow there? What are you going to grow there? Where are you going to sell it? Where are you going to build it? Where is it in the city? Once I know that, once I know what I'm going to grow and where I'm going to grow it, then we can do the rest of the design. We can figure out what the growing system's going to be. We can figure out how to design the greenhouse for that climate. We can figure out how to integrate it into the building that we're using. We can get the plans. Once we have a full set of plans, we can cost estimate the whole job and raise the right amount of money. We can bring that to the Department of Buildings and we can get the plans, start construction, and then begin the operations. And then the most important thing on this list to me is the operations. Everything else, you just do it once, you know, but once it's operating, you're doing that forever, you know, until you make all, pay all the money back and you are now just running, you know, a profitable company. So, you know, designing for people who are actually working in there all the time is so important. You know, so for us, there's three of us that are partners, me, Viraj, and Eric. We're an awesome team. You don't need a lot of people to do this. You need the right people. So Eric handles all the finance, Viraj handles all the business development, and I handle the technical side and operations. You know, so for us, you know, and us answering these questions that I would think that the vertical farm has to answer is, you know, what are you going to do with the product? You know, when we started Gotham Greens, this is our product on the shelf at Whole Foods in New York City. This is what we wanted. We decided we wanted to go for greens. We wanted this shelf space year-round in a packaged retail product. So, you know, we worked with our customers in the city, figuring out what's our price point, what products are we going to do, you know, what's the processing necessary to get it. And everything really works backwards. It wasn't, oh, what is the design of our greenhouse, and then what does that kind of spit out? It was really starting from the end, what did we want here, and how do we get there? The year-round shelf space was important, and that's what moved us towards controlled environment agriculture. There are a lot of products that we want to move into. You know, for our first greenhouse right now we sell 4 different lettuce products and a basil. There's, you know, a lot of greens we can move into, but 5 is a good fit for us right now, so that we have some diversity. But any more, we would just have too little volume of each of these products to make it to have enough customers. So where do we put this? You know, it seems with the vertical farm, you know, there's going to be some discussion that you could kind of just look around the world and decide where you want to drop this thing. For us, it's in New York City because that's where the three of us live, you know, and it happened to have a great market. So this has really worked out. But in looking around, you know, we looked all over the city. As a company, we are absolutely not committed to rooftops at all. You know, our customers love it. The press loves it. It's like a nice story. But we're not married to that at all. It's just the space that's really worked for us so far. It's unshaded. You know, we've looked around a lot of vacant lots. We've looked at areas on the outskirts of the city, and really for how close we want to be to the market in an unshaded area and that's affordable, a roof has been a good location for us. It comes with its own challenges. Getting through the zoning and permitting is tricky. Dealing with landing this structure and all the weights inside on a building, doing all the negotiations with the landlord for what are the lease terms going to look like here. You know, we don't own the buildings that we land on. So for us, you know, we had the product that we wanted to do. We wanted the greens, and we had the location. Okay, so I have a roof, and I want to grow lettuce. How do you do that? You know, and so then we just start going through this list. You know, what is our greenhouse design? What structure? What are the controls? We're in New York City. How much heating do we need? How much cooling do we need? The CO2, the glazing and supplemental lighting. You know, we needed lighting in winter. The glazing is also really interesting to think about in the city. We have to scaffold the building and crane everything up for construction. So if you're going to pick like a thin polyethylene film and you have to reglaze that in a few years, there's some real costs to doing that. You know, glass you won't have to replace for a long time, but it's really heavy, so that's going to add to your loads on the building. For the production system, you know, we had greens, so we could think about what kind of growing system fits that, how are we going to get the nutrients there, the irrigation system, what's the layout going to look like, and a lot of the layout, how are we going to integrate the grow out space with how we're going to process it after, how are we going to get it from, you know, growing in our greenhouse to one of those nice little clamshells. So attachment to the building is one of the challenges that we have. There's not one right way to do this. So we have, this is our first greenhouse that's been open for over a year. We have 2 that we're trying to get to break ground before the end of this year, also in New York City. And in all 3 of these structures, we've handled this in a different way. So there's, you know, a lot of different things. It's going to depend on, you know, the architects and the structural engineers and really the building that you're dealing with. But generally, you know, we have all the dead loads of the structure. We have all the loads inside for the growing system, people, material handling. And I mean, a big one here is, you know, all this water and all these point loads. And, you know, how are you going to handle moving your water around the system? Can the roof take it? Do you have to add extra dunnage? For the zoning, New York City has had a zoning amendment that has made this a little bit easier to get us around some of the FAR issues. when you're adding a greenhouse, you're adding another story to a building. So greenhouses were just given a waiver to count towards the floor to area ratio, but there's still plenty of stuff that you have to do to get through the local building code, means of egress and fire ratings, and so there's plenty of headaches there. For our climate control, you know, we really wanted year-round production. I think to be a local producer and want the shelf space that we get, it was really important for us to promise our customers that we can take that shelf space year-round. We wanted to use technology that exists. We didn't want to try and invent anything. We figured out how we like to do things and things we want to change, and I think we feel a little more free to make some changes and do things differently moving forward. But we had enough that was automatically kind of a variable the first time around. There are a lot of energy costs associated with a greenhouse. You know, for us, it works. We have solar on the roof. I'll show some pictures in a minute, but it's just an important thing to consider, you know, when looking at the vertical farm, like everyone's mentioned. The growing system that we picked is nutrient film technique. There's a lot of different ways you can grow greens and lettuce. This system worked for us for a couple reasons. The deep ponds are a pretty popular way to grow greens. Landlords don't love the idea of you building a huge swimming pool on the roof. And the structural engineers don't really love the idea either. So this was, you know, a really good growing system for us to use. Movable, flexible, waist height, really good for workers. So this is what we went with. The biggest problems that we have had is, again, dealing with the water storage. How are all these systems going to run? Where do you put all these tanks? And all the plumbing. You can't bury anything. I can't bury my water cistern. I can't bury all the plumbing to get from one place to the next. Everything is above grade for us. That also is something that made nutrient film technique a good choice. You know, I have a couple of feet of room to play with as opposed to raft. Everything's already on the ground. Construction, again, you know, it's the city. You know, we have a construction management firm, you know, who is well-versed on New York City construction. But, you know, we have permits. I mean, any greenhouse, you're going to have to grade your site, pour your concrete footers. There's a lot of construction involved. But ours, you know, all the tractor trailers come in, and we needed the permits to have the street closed. We had to scaffold the building. We have the cranes. We have the site protection. We had about 15 trades on the job to get this built. This was built, so this last winter, we had one of the most mild winters that New York City's seen in a while, which was nice. But the winter before, when we were under construction, we got like a few feet of snow, it seemed, every week. So besides like all the trades we had, we needed crews to come and do snow removal because every trade said, you know, it's not our job to shovel the work site. So there was just and then where do you put all this snow that was on the roof? So we got it built. We started. We seeded the plants and put our first crop in. Not this last May, but the May before that. We started sales last June, so it's been just over a year. We just can't grow it fast enough. You know, there is such demand for the product. The quality is unbelievable. A lot of it is just because of the freshness. We are harvesting and delivering the same day, sometimes next day. You know, we're excited to be putting up a few more of these. Some of the energy demands, you know, anything, and, you know, obviously we have heating and we have natural gas that we're using for the heaters, but there are real electrical demands, and we are using primarily, you know, solar radiation for our lighting source. But we, you know, our solar is a net metered grid tied system. So really, if we're producing more than we're using, which never happens, but the meter would run backwards, you know, or the rest we can get from the grid. And so, you know, what we see too is that we need the most electricity in winter when we're running the lights. I mean, that's the real demand that we have, and we're getting the most out of the solar in the summer. A few more things I just wanted to bring up related to the city. New York City has excellent water. You know, we send water and tissue samples out every single week. The New York City just source water is excellent. We use a fraction of it because of the kind of growing system we're using and that we recirculate it.
But one of the things that makes it tricky on a rooftop, if you're just using an open single pass system, here you have New York City water, it's already pressurized for you, it's great quality, and you could get rid of it. But no, we're going to collect it and reuse it, so now we have to add all those issues in plumbing. You know, how are we going to move all that water around? So we need a few feet to work with. And now you have more water storage loads on the roof to think about. We really need people who know how to do this. So, you know, the technical skill and staff is really important. New York City does not have an agricultural workforce, so we're running like a little grower boot camp there. And, you know, and are hiring, so. For bugs, the IPM, I was kind of thinking maybe in the city we would be so lucky. I mean, I remember getting to work at South Pole, and there was no bugs there. I mean, it was just amazing. It takes one problem totally out of the equation. So I thought, you know, maybe we would get lucky like that in the city, and that is not the case. Anything that would normally come in a greenhouse, you know, we've loopers, aphids, thrips, whatever it is still there in the city. We don't use any pesticides, but we still have a really strong IPM program to handle everything that comes in. A couple other things in the city, the CO2 levels are very high. It's great. So it comes with a lot of other things, I'm sure, that we are not measuring, but the CO2 levels are, you know, higher than anything. It's what you would like supplement to, so we do not supplement CO2. We're really close to the market. And that has a lot to do with the product shelf life. You know, people have told us, they're like, it seems like your produce just doesn't go bad. Do you put something special in it? And people are used to, you know, when we talk to our customers, a lot of the stuff they get is already 8 days old. You know, ours is that day. That means not only do our customers get that shelf life, but the end consumer does. You know, and that shelf life and freshness is passed on. It also makes our customers have 100% sell-through, which they have like never even seen before us. And a lot of energy use in agriculture is from a lot of this waste. You know, there's papers that have come out saying that 50% of what's grown is wasted. And we have 0% waste. And I think that's a really big point in the energy argument. So my main point is that urban farming works. We have been operating a year. We're cash flow positive. You know, we're ready to build more. An urban rooftop absolutely works for commercial production. All these issues can be overcome. We can do it year round. We are doing it with supplemental lighting using, you know, natural radiation. And, you know, just the point that a vertical farm is not the same as a rooftop greenhouse. So there's lessons to be learned, I think, from some of the points from us. But it will have its own unique challenges. And then I was asked to put a last slide of what I thought were the challenges and some of where I would want to steer the discussion today. And just based on, you know, how we went through our steps, I think defining a purpose would be a really good objective for the meeting, you know, because there's so many different things. It's good for the environment. You know, there's education opportunities, there's a business, there's food security. I think each one would have its own reason to be designed, but I think selecting a real narrow scope would be helpful. Is it private? Does this thing have to support itself financially? How much, you know, can you spend on it? What's been really interesting for me is getting to work with my partner, Eric, you know, getting to funnel all of my greenhouse knowledge through someone who has such an understanding of the investment and the capital and how the cash flow works has been awesome, you know, because we can work together and say, can I buy this piece of really expensive equipment or no? You know, and you make the decisions necessary, because ultimately, you know, for us to move on to secondary objectives down the road of it, having an education component or an environmental piece, we have to pay the bills, right? I have to make payroll every week. We have to pay back all the debt. So, you know, it has to be a viable business. So others is just, you know, to look at the real estate value in the city. You know, we have a lease situation. You know, I don't know if the vertical farm is going to own a New York City block, which is expensive. So looking at these things is important. What are the energy needs and the financial and environmental implications for that, for providing the lighting? Again, just from the cash flow, you know, can you afford the utility bills? What are you going to grow? And I think this would have a lot to do with the beginning of defining the purpose, because if the vertical farm is about food security and that we are growing wheat and corn, you know, that's really different than if we're trying to grow, you know, high-end value crops. And then, you know, what is ultimately the price to the consumer? So that's it. Thanks.
Thank you, Jen. Can you guys hear me? Sorry. Thank you, Jen. We have time for a couple of questions, and then we're going to take a short break. So in the back.
What are you finding in terms of floor loading?
The question is, what are you finding in terms of floor loading?
It depends on a couple things. So you're going to have, you know, your greenhouse structure and your dead load. So, I mean, a lot of it, you know, there's some greenhouse guys in the room here that can tell you this, but it's going to depend a lot on your truss size, and a lot of it's going to depend on, you know, the snow loads for your building code. So, and then your live loads, you know, again, it's really how you've packaged together all the different pieces of your technology. Your water, you know, water is, you know, 8 pounds a square foot. So are you building huge vertical tanks and then pumping the water back up somehow, or do you have low profiles? So there's not really, I mean, if you have something specific that you're looking at.
For instance, what would you say that your load is on your existing facility? 50 pounds a square foot, 100, 200?
Under, yeah.
20.
Okay, we have, there's lots of questions, and this is great, but I do want to, we have the first question from our Twitter feed here. So from Hort Americas, we have a question. How are you accessing the right labor?
We've been really lucky in this. It's just kind of like a feed that we've had come in. So we hired, you know, a few people as supervisors, and we had our team as partners. But really, a lot of the guys that were involved in the construction of the facility through all the trades were, you know, they have in and out work. They were like, oh, is this going to be a full-time job? You know, can we come in? Can we apply? And then, you know, friends of friends. And it's just, we've had actually a lot more people apply. And a lot of it is unskilled hourly labor. And so we haven't had any problem filling that. We just look for a certain kind of person. So I'm always looking for just people that are really detail-oriented. You know, I can teach you what to do with what you see, but I just need to know that you're the kind of person that sees it. You know, did you find a bug, or does this plant look a little different today? So if they're, you know, we're looking for staff that notices that, and we'll train you what to do with it. And then on a higher level, you know, I think that's a challenge for the whole industry, is, you know, hiring people, you know, to be the real growers.
Thanks. All right, one more quick question. Yellow shirt.
Again, I missed how many square feet?
Oh, I didn't even say. Yeah, our first greenhouse is 12,000 square feet. And the next few that are in line, the next one's 20,000, then 60,000, then 100,000.
So you probably figured out from the context, but the question was how many square feet?
Right. Now, along with that, you've been in operation 1 year.
Yep. Yep.
So the question is, define what you mean by cash flow positive with all the costs you start up.
So with all our costs, it has not paid off all the debt, right? But it's able to service the monthly payments and be profitable. With all costs for the facility and servicing all the investors and the debt, cash positive above that.
Okay, so 12,000 square feet, cash flow positive, and that's what's leading you to go for 20,000 and 60,000.
Yeah, there's a real compelling business case.
All right, so we could go on all day. This is a fascinating conversation, but we'll go on all day, in fact. But we have to take a break now. We have a very tight schedule, so you have exactly 9 minutes to get up and walk around.
Get
and
some coffee outside.
Get some coffee.
You will get another chance at these speakers. They'll be on a panel after the next session, so you'll have a chance to ask these questions. Keep those questions
in mind. We will convene here at 11 o'clock sharp. So we'll see you then.
Thank you.
I really appreciate it. You got us back.